Yes.
I give an hour.
Where are they? I need them.
We're having a good time over here, sorry about that, gang.
Yes, we'll call meeting to order. Meeting of 7/94/95, December 12th, 1994, 7:30 p.m. We'll have the roll call from the clerk, please.
Chairman Jordan.
Yep.
Counselor Chapel.
Yep.
Counselor Cogswell.
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck.
Yep.
Counselor Linnell.
Here.
Counselor Marvin.
Here.
And Counselor McLaughlin.
Here.
All, please rise and sleep quiet.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic over which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes of meeting 6/94/95, held November 14th, 1994. What's your wishes? Anybody have any changes?
Move their acceptance.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, a vote. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Any citizens out there that care to speak of an item not on the agenda? If not, we shall move on to reports and correspondence.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
The Regional Waste Services Board meeting of November was on the 17th, and we took up the financial setup that I told you about at the last meeting, and it was approved unanimously by the board, which made us all happy. And we also took up a new policy, and I'll report to you on that on the next one, when we get that one approved, new policy statement for the 28 towns. Tomorrow is our executive committee meeting, all day, 8:30 in the morning till 3:30 in the afternoon at Wolf Neck Farm for plans for all of next year. So I'll have a good report for you, I hope, in January when we get done with the meeting tomorrow. And then Thursday night, the executive committee meets at 5 o'clock and the board at 7, and that is our end of December, we hope. I spent last Thursday evening with the recycling committee of the Cape. I think it's only fair to report to everyone my impression of that committee, and it's outstanding. They are really interested and really had questions. They had a representative from Regional Waste there, so I had to be careful what I said because she could correct me, you know. And they did a wonderful evening together, and they are really gung-ho, and they've got Cape Elizabeth on its percentage total of the tonnage up to about 37.5%. And the state goal within the next 2 or 3 years is 50%, so we're well on the way. In fact, we're either first, second, or third all the time in the total communities within the system. First, second, or third. We lose out some months, and we go ahead other months. So it's really coming along great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor McGlaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Wanted to report back to the council that the November GP COG Executive Board meeting was a presentation, was a panel presentation on customer service. It was an abbreviated panel. We had Bill Richards and Deb Cook do presentation, had some very good conversation afterwards. And one other opportunity I've had within the last month was to attend both the public presentation and then a luncheon today with the involvement with Maine Medical Center. They were one of the four entities that worked to compile a community health profile of the greater Portland region, which is very interesting. There was newspaper coverage of this talking about some of the habits we in the region have. some of the abuses that we indulge in, but also some of the very good medical care that is available to us. I was very impressed with this and with the conversation at Maine Med today with the collaborative process that they are looking at. They were talking again about customer service, the range of customers that they have, which is similar to the conversations that we have, the range of customers we serve. And it was just very interesting to get that perspective from a different entity. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor Cogsell spoke to me the other day and mentioned that a citizen or two, a number of citizens, had spoken to her questioning the town's investments in light of what's happened in Orange County, California, and in other locales. I just want to reassure everyone that all of the town's investments are safely invested in collateralized repurchase agreements through local banks. We do receive collateral in the mail each and every day for every investment, and the citizens and bondholders of Cape Elizabeth need not worry as to the safety of the town's investments.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, on a couple of other matters, one of the council's goals this past year has been the area of customer service. And would like to mention to the public that we now have, actually the six in my hand, but a series of eight brochures that outline the different services offered by the community. These happen to follow the different departments. These are available here in the town office, and I think are quite interesting. In doing this, it's been quite a project. All of the different departments have been involved, the department heads, some of the clerical folks within each department, and would like to particularly thank Artie Green, who's one of our dispatchers over at Public Safety, who works the late shift. And during that late shift, he was good enough to actually do some of the composing of these for us on the computer over at Public Safety. So really appreciate his extra efforts as well as all those who participated in the process. Also, in the area of customer service, there's good and bad news. In the next two mornings, all of the folks in the front end of the building, with the exception of myself, will be going through customer service training during the morning hours from about 8 to noon. Therefore, we're going to be having very, very limited service in the office the next two mornings. If someone comes in to re-register a vehicle, they'll have to have it done by the town manager, which will be, I would hope not too many would come in. It's a very risky prospect. Nonetheless, we will do what we can to help folks through the next couple of mornings. And beyond that, my hope is that the training that occurs will be well worthwhile the inconvenience over the next two mornings. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? I'd just like to report one thing. The other day, Irv Chappell and Dick Dahlbeck and Janet McLaughlin and myself attended a dinner that our Lighthouse director put together for the volunteers that she has over there. And I was amazed at the number of volunteers and what they do. And I think they do a tremendous job. She had a little gift for each one of them. And I really enjoyed myself. I think it was a great day. And I think those people really appreciate it. Now we'll move on to a public hearing on town ways. Does anybody from the public would care to speak on town ways? Hearing none, I'll move that the public hearing is closed, and we'll move on to item 78 to consider the adoption of a revised town ways ordinance and take any necessary action. What's your wishes? Then we have I believe everybody received a copy of the changes in the town ways, and I believe Councilor Cogshaw has a amendment that she would like to bring to this group tonight. Is that correct?
Yes, thank you. I decided to propose this amendment after a comment from the Director of Public Works, and the new language would include the words, identification shall be placed in the area to be excavated so that the identification will be eliminated after the job is completed. And that would be inserted in the new text following that of letters no larger than 12 inches high. And then we go into this amendment. This would just eliminate any possibility of future arguments and have it completely clear as to where they're to be placed.
Anybody else? Counselor Dahlback.
I was just ready to move the ordinance as amended by Phyllis.
Second it.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody else in comment? One way or the other? I see no problem with it, but I'm just wondering, and I would like to ask a question to Counselor Cogshaw or the Public Works Director, which, who cares to answer it? Will they always get the name or initials in the proper place as far as digging? Will it be off, or will it? I don't want them to dig up any extra road just to get rid of the name.
No, hopefully if it's placed properly, that shouldn't be a problem. Even if they were doing ditch work, they could actually put the initials in the ditch with white paint, and it would be gone as soon as the job was done. So I don't see a problem with it. It should work.
Okay, thank you. I'm just wondering if it's, I'm not too concerned about whether it's necessary, because I feel that all the letter and whatever you should be in the ditch area anyway, on the edge of the road and not in the middle of the road. So, and I'm just wondering if the language covers it or not, but I will vote for it in hopes that it will cover it and not have it somebody's name written all over the street. Anybody else got any other comments? Ready for the question? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, so vote. 7-0. Item 79, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee and take any necessary action. I believe that's Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Appointments Committee consists of Councilor Linnell, Councilor Marvin, and myself as chairman. And over the past month, actually within a three-evening span, I believe it was, we met with a very good number of people who had indicated an interest in serving on a variety of boards, committees, and commissions for the town. And I would like to put those names forth as the report from the full committee. To the Area Development Council, we recommend Gregory Cross to serve the one-year position there. Greg has previously served as the town's representative on this council. He is a research economist. To the Town Planning Board, we recommend reappointing Steve Parkhurst to a three-year term to 1/1/98. Steve has served one regular term on the board, and he is a real estate broker. We also recommend appointing Janet McKay. This is kind of a reappointment to some extent. Janet had been on the board before. She's an attorney. Most recently, she's been serving as an associate member since September. She's also a member of the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, also known as ZORC. The third appointee recommended for Planning Board is Roy Carlson for a three-year term. Roy has been an associate member for the past year. He's a retired customer service and sales manager. So those three folks are recommended for three-year terms to the Planning Board. If you remember, last month we eliminated the associate position on Planning Board, so these will be three regular members. Zoning Board of Appeals, we have three recommendations. First is Judith Dooley. Judy has served one full term on the board. She does have real estate background. She told us she was interested in helping residents resolve their problems due to a conflict of zoning, but within the ordinance guidelines. Second recommendation is Amory Houghton. Amory has been an associate member since September. He's retired from the Portland newspapers. We're recommending Amory for the one-year term, and this is to keep the correct number of people in the different year rotations. Recommended for a three-year term is Elizabeth Monahan. Liz is a mortgage loan officer and brings an understanding of the permitting process and of the applicant's concerns to this board. Conservation Commission, We recommend the appointment of Alan Wicken to a three-year term. Al is a physical therapist. He's a great outdoor enthusiast. He supports the commission's work to protect the town's natural resources. The Riverside Cemetery Trustees, we recommend the reappointment of Ed McComb for a three-year term. Ed has already been on for one term, and he's participated in the development of the cemetery's master plan. For Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, we recommend the reappointment of Judy Simons. Judy has served on the trustees for the past year. She was filling an unexpired term for us in that capacity. Judy supports developing the long-range plan for the library. We recommend a new appointee, Kathy Kaczynski. Kathy promotes lifelong learning. She's sensitive to the need for stretching limited dollars. She works as an assistant special ed director in the Lewiston School Department. For the Cable Television Advisory Committee, we recommend the reappointment of Lee Chase for a three-year term. Lee serves both on the committee and in the control room and kind of meandering around back and forth back there occasionally. Lee talked to us about wanting to provide more programming and coordination with the schools. We thank you for both your capacities. New appointees to cable television would be Milton Hollowell for a two-year term to keep the rotation intact. Milt is retired. He's interested in getting involved in town affairs. A former member of a number of Cape boards and the selectmen, and all, it was very encouraging to get Milt to apply. He understands the need for widening the range of CETV programs. The third appointee, also new to cable television, is Grace Myers. Grace is an energetic homemaker, and she sees the opportunity to combine her interest in the arts, the library, and recycling for bringing about some new programming, cable TV. You can perhaps pick up that those were the three other commissions she actually applied for, and we were able to sway her a bit to go on to the cable TV board. Fort Williams Advisory Commission, we recommend the reappointment of Paul Thielen for a three-year term. Paul is currently chairman of that commission. He is a local attorney. New appointee to Fort Williams Commission recommendation is Nancy Sears. Nancy is a travel agent. She grew up in Cape Elizabeth, has lived away for the past 40 years, and is very glad to be back in town. She's interested in preserving the beauty of the fort and investigating additional revenue sources. Excuse me. The Arts Commission, we have five recommendations, two reappointees, the first being Susan Brazil. Sue promotes fun projects for the committee, for the community and the committee, plus accessibility of fine arts at all levels. The second reappointee is Marcia Donahue. Marcia is an artist and gallery manager who brings a lot of energy to the commission. New appointees being proposed for the Arts Commission, Patricia Fortunato. Pat's an art educator and interior designer. She's interested in preserving and promoting the arts in Cape Elizabeth. Second new appointee, and this would be for a one-year term, is Mrs. D. Lee Rich. Mrs. Rich is a director of the Ginkgo Asian Art in Portland, and she's interested in making art a bridge between cultures and between individuals. Third new appointee for a one-year term is Jane Roberts. Jane's a self-employed artist. She's a relatively new resident and interested in contributing to the community. For the Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee, we recommend the reappointment of Nancy Masterton. Nancy is a former counselor and state representative. For Personnel Appeals Board, we recommend the appointment of Sharon Roberts. Sherry has previously served on the Cable TV Advisory Committee. She wants to be involved again. She is currently working as a director at Blue Cross Blue Shield. For Recycling Committee, we recommend the appointment of Scott Collins. Scott has been on the committee for the past year, so this is a reappointment, and he's brought a lot of good energy to that committee. He has involved some of his fellow employees in some of the committee's projects. Another reappointment to the committee would be Jean Fine. Jean has a background as a botanist and as an environmental educator. For Family Fun Day, you should have received at your place tonight an addendum which lists three appointees recommended to Family Fun Day. Elizabeth Monahan, who you may remember was also recommended for Zoning Board of Appeals. Liz would bring her organizational skills and her very strong enthusiasm to this committee. Secondly would be Karen Price. Karen is a new resident in town. She's very interested in the entertainment possibilities for Family Fun Day. Third recommendation is Brenda Miley. The Miley family greatly enjoys Family Fun Day, and Brenda looks forward to helping organize this event for June 95. I now want to also let you know what the remaining positions, unfilled positions are. We have not successfully filled all positions, and we're continuing to work on this. We do have one three-year opening on the Board of Assessment Review. Fortunately for everybody, I would say that board was not as busy as we thought they might be this fall with the revow coming out last summer, but it's still a very important board to have up at full speed with three members, so we are looking for somebody else for that. Conservation Commission, we have one opening. Again, that would be a three-year position. Cable Television Advisory Committee, we have one opening. Again, a three-year position. And again, for that, we're looking for people who are interested in broadening the programming that's currently being presented on cable TV. Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee, we do have one opening. Appointments Committee does not recommend filling this. It's our expectation that this committee will complete its charge within the calendar year of 1995, and we think it's quite a bit to expect of someone to be brought up to speed on that committee. I believe their report is due to the council actually in April. Recycling Committee, we do have one opening on that, and that would be a one-year term. And Family Fun Day, we now have two openings. So given all that, I move the council, if you want, take positive action on the recommendations of the Appointments Committee.
Second. Moved and seconded. Anybody got any comments? Yes. Council Dahlbeck.
Yes, one of these people, persons, has been nominated for two committees. Do we have a policy on that? And, well, first, do we have a policy on that?
I did pose that question to the manager, and my recollection is he said we do not have a policy on that. The Appointments Committee felt that it was not a conflict for someone to serve on the Zoning Board of Appeals and on Family Fun Day. There would be some combinations that we would not even consider bringing forth to you, but that one we felt very comfortable with.
Following on then on that, we still have some vacancies. I know there are people who serve on one or two of these, you know, a committee, whatever it might be. Which committee is not the most active thing around? Not one of these that meets monthly or maybe even quarterly. And I just wonder if we're being too tight and trying to restrict people to just one committee.
Okay. We can broaden our search. Thank you. Good suggestion.
Anybody else? Any comment? Ready for the question? All those in favor? It's indicated by raising your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. 7-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good job. Item 80, consider entering into executive session to discuss the legal counsel, to discuss with the legal counsel, and the status of pending litigation in the matter of the Plummer versus Town of Cape Elizabeth, and take any necessary action. What's your wishes?
I move.
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. Where shall we?
My office. You might announce that we will be coming back for more business.
And the clock is running.
We will meet at the manager's office, and we'll be back here shortly, I hope.
Don't turn that
check down. The number of seats up there.
What about the comp?
I've got maps up there.
That's fine. Here.
What about what?
Comp. That's busy.
Yeah, the little lady.
All right, how are you? Great night, huh?
motion was brought against us.
Taking a glance at it already.
Thanks.
Most of this.
Yeah, but just don't.
Alone, that you don't have to read.
Stuff we already see.
Good for you.
Sunrise.
Under protection.
Sure.
Hey, so we're back from executive session. Do I hear a motion that we reconvene the meeting?
Mr. Chairman, I move we come out of executive session.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? We was in an executive session, and I believe we will have a motion to continue negotiations with the plumbers. Do I hear our motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we authorize the manager to continue settlement negotiations with the estate of Fred Plummer and FS Plummer Company.
Second.
Do I hear a second? Anybody got any comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0. Item 81. See, that's moving ahead. To consider a report from the Planning Board on accessory dwelling units and take any necessary action. And I believe the chairman of the Planning Board is here, and I would like to ask, come forward and kind of review your report to us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Emery.
I do have a handout. I'm not sure exactly what you have with your packet, but this may help to explain something that I'll present.
Yes.
We don't do that on the basis. Hey there.
You got it.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and councilors. I'm here tonight representing the Planning Board, and what I'd like to do is to review briefly the purpose of the ordinance, give a brief introduction, go through the proposed ordinance as an overview, and then review the revisions that the Planning Board has suggested to your draft ordinance language, and then discuss, again briefly, considerations or reservations as they were stated in my letter regarding debate and discussions during Planning Board deliberations. As you're aware, the Planning Board recommended the advisory dwelling unit revisions to the Town Council at our regular November 15th, 1994 meeting. Prior to that, the Planning Board held several workshops, most and many of which were attended by the general public as part of our new policy, and we also held a public hearing on October 18th, 1994. And let it just be said that this is something that the public has certainly had a wide range of opinions on, and we heard a lot of very good arguments on both sides. During part of the public hearing, there was a request or a suggestion that the council conduct a survey to provide some evidence of a need for an accessory dwelling unit, particularly with some of the discussions on in-law apartments and affordable housing, perhaps. In discussing this with the town planner, it was noted that indeed the council has conducted a survey. A study was done in 1989, and it was titled the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Report. A brief overview of the ordinance. We had taken and expanded the purpose statement to include some language that would give one an indication for the purpose of the ordinance, something that we've seen in much of the ordinance and we feel is helpful to applicants and people using the ordinance, and particularly helpful if the historic knowledge is lost in terms of the original draft of the ordinance. I think we're fortunate in this committee that we have people who continue to serve on various boards who were around when wetland regulations were deliberated, and they understand the purposes. But three areas that we stressed were consistent. We wanted to be sure that this was based somewhat on the comprehensive plan and the goals of the council, and to ensure that there was an adequate supply of housing types and varieties within the single-family district. We wanted to be sure that it was utilized only where the single-family character of neighborhoods could be maintained, where there'd be an assurance of that, and that it would continue to be reviewed under the conditional use standards and in addition to the other ordinance standards that were set forth below. Parenthetically, there is concern about the use of conditional use standards as review, because use standard number 4, and I'll get to this in more detail later, has historically made it difficult to use the accessory dwelling unit provision, and that standard states that there shall be no lowering of property values in adjacent dwelling units within the neighborhood. Under the proposed ordinance, item 1 deals with lot size. The council had proposed a 15,000 square foot lot size, and the planning board, in reviewing lot size, wondered why it was 15,000 square feet. We had the background from the planner of a lot of discussion that took place in the ordinance committee, but we couldn't quite see what the difference was between 15 and 12. And then obviously there's some difference between 15 and 20. The two existing zones in town, the C and A zones, the C zone has a minimum square footage of 20,000 square feet, and the A zone has a minimum square footage of 80,000 square feet. And in your packet, we did just we just looked at the graphic comparison of the minimum size house that's required under the ordinance, plus a garage and in some cases a breezeway, and we looked at the impact of that on different lot sizes. In the upper left hand corner of the sheet, we show is a square lot of 100 feet by 100 feet or 10,000 square feet. That's a third smaller than the lot size at 15,000 square feet that's being recommended. The second lot size is 12,000 square feet. That's the one that the planning board is proposing. And we compare that with a 15,000 square foot lot below that the council had suggested in its draft ordinance. And in the upper right hand corner of the sheet, we look at the minimum lot size in the residence A, which is 20,000 square feet. And in the lower right hand corner is an alternative view of the 15,000 square feet, where we use 100 foot of frontage. And it was generally our considered opinion that there was little difference between the impact on a 12,000 square foot lot and a 15,000 square foot lot. And during deliberations, a concern was raised as to who would most need to take advantage of this ordinance. It was felt that perhaps those people would probably be on lots that would be smaller than 15,000 square feet in many cases. Ultimately, what we're suggesting is that perhaps during the council deliberation, you can look more closely at whether 12,000 square feet, 10,000 square feet, or some other square footage is an appropriate size and have a basis for determining that area. The second item under the ordinance is that the existing residence must be a single-family detached residence, and that its gross floor area is 1,500 square feet, excluding garages. That's not a terribly difficult threshold to meet. A 24 by 36 house, two stories, can meet that threshold. The key here is we have single-family and it is detached. Under item three, the accessory dwelling unit shall not occupy more than 25% of the resulting floor area of the dwelling. If one were to take a 1,500 square foot minimum house size and add to that the maximum size of the dwelling unit that you'll see that, is stated in the ordinance, one would end up with a total footprint or square footage of 2,100 square feet. 600 square feet is about 28% of that total building area. So the maximum unit size exceeds the percentage that one could have in total floor area. But even at 25%, one could still have a 525 square foot accessory dwelling unit in a 1,500 square foot house. Again, the minimum size is 300 square feet, which is 10 by 30, to put it in perspective, and the maximum is 600 square feet. As part of our exercise, I found an example of an apartment, a small apartment, efficiency apartment, in an architectural magazine that was a noted project in San Diego, and gave that to the town planner. So it is possible to fit a kitchenette, a pull-out couch, and have a reasonable view within a 300 square foot footprint. Under item four, it states that any addition in area for the accessory dwelling unit shall not exceed 15 square feet of the gross floor area of the house. At the last minute, I was checking this with a town planner, and if one were to take a 1,500 square foot house and multiply it by 15%, one ends up with a 225 square foot addition. Now, if one were assuming that the only purpose of the addition was for the accessory dwelling unit, obviously that 225 square feet is too small. The minimum dwelling unit, accessory dwelling unit, is 300 square feet, excuse me. But in discussing it with the town planner, I was quickly reminded that the good part of this is that we don't expect that accessory dwelling units are going to be always in additions, that they'll be part of them will be alterations within the existing size of the building. And the other concern that we had, that if one were to add on to the house, that a 15% addition would be in keeping with scale with the rest of the house. As one gets into larger additions, they would tend to overpower the existing house. Item five was parking. The ordinance requires one additional parking space for the accessory dwelling unit. It, as was provided in the draft, should be set a minimum 5 feet from adjacent property lines, and that in addition, that the location and landscaping be compatible with existing and adjacent structures. The council draft had also recommended that there be a separate access to the street, and I'll get into that into a further discussion later. Under item six, we asked that the exterior alteration preserve the single-family appearance. One way of doing that, and those are illustrated here, is to preserve the formal front entrance. There's nothing worse than a generality, but in the middle of this sheet, one sees what could be typically a colonial house or whatever you want to call it in Cape Elizabeth. Typically has a center entrance and then balanced windows on either side. Recently in my neighborhood, I don't know if they're accessory dwelling units, but there have been conversions of houses initially for in-law apartments. In one case, the center door was added. The house was lengthened by about 10 feet, and another door was added in the same plane to the end of the house. The neighbors down the street were acted a little more consistently with what we're suggesting, is that the main entrance remains the formal ceremonial entrance to the house, and that if entrance faces the street for the accessory dwelling unit, that it be located in the L or out of the main plane with the existing entrance. The bottom illustration shows what we're most concerned about, and it probably illustrates it too nicely, but in Portland, for example, there have been a lot of two-family houses developed, or two-unit houses that are literally two townhouses put together with no setback, and the doors are on each side. The windows are symmetrical, and it very much appears to be a two-family house. And it's with this provision that we're hoping to avoid that appearance in a single-family neighborhood. Item seven says that the accessory dwelling unit shall be approved for any structure that includes a home occu-, no accessory dwelling unit shall be approved for any structure that includes a home occupation, nor shall a home occupation be permitted in a structure that includes an accessory dwelling unit. This was an interesting issue because the concern was that once the single-family homeowner had dipped into the home occupation, that going into the well of the accessory dwelling unit may be asking too much of his neighbors. And conversely, if one first got an accessory dwelling unit, it would be too much to ask for that they would then have a home occupation. I would expect some discussion on this, particularly in light of the electronic nature of home occupations these days. And lastly, under item eight was the discussion of ownership, in which it states, "The single-family home and the accessory dwelling unit shall be held in the same ownership and be owner-occupied." It doesn't state that either one or the other has to be occupied by the property owner. The owner of the property could live in the accessory dwelling unit or in the single-family house. And that the person or entity receiving the conditional use permit must record and have an attested copy of the conditional use permit registered in the Cumberland County deeds within 90 days of receiving approval. Within the revisions to the town center draft, I mean to the town council draft, I have something on my mind for some reason. We wanted to express in writing the needs of and represent the needs of the Cape Elizabeth families, that this wasn't an arbitrary issue, that this was to meet the needs of our citizens, and that we were at the same time very concerned about preserving the single-family character within the neighborhoods. And that was in response to many comments that we heard during the public hearing regarding one of the highest values of a single-family neighborhood is the preservation of property values. And we felt that as long as homes continued to look like single-family homes, that it would help to retain the property value. And thirdly, we want to clarify that unlike the council draft and as a suggestion from Corporation Council, that the new construction may include an accessory dwelling unit. This wasn't just for existing houses, but that new construction could also include a unit. And we also, as I said before, referenced the comprehensive plan, the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Report, within which there's a recommendation for flexibility in the creation of affordable dwelling units. Under lot size, again, we did reduce it from 15,000 square foot minimum to 12,000 square feet, and I've discussed the graphics that you've seen before. On the house size, it does remain at 1,500 square feet. Again, a 24 foot by 32 foot two-story structure is 1,500 square feet or thereabouts. We also took into consideration the town attorney's noting of the inconsistency between existing homes with recent additions, which would not be allowed to add an accessory dwelling unit for some number of years, and a new home which could immediately have an accessory dwelling unit. And I believe the concern on, from the council there was that people would go out and start putting additions on their houses so they could qualify for the minimum square footage of an accessory dwelling unit. And I guess our feeling was that people at the same time could go out and build new houses if they wanted to put accessory dwelling units in. So we've dropped the provision regarding recent additions. Under the parking space, the planning board believes that it's very typical within a single-family neighborhood, particularly with extended families that and with teenagers, that one goes out, and I guess particularly in this community, one can easily find two, three, four automobiles parked in the driveway, stacked parked, and one plays dominoes, certainly as my family did growing up with a bunch of teenagers, someone's car has to be moved to get the other person out, that's what you do. I think that's more typical of a single-family neighborhood than having a separate parking area, particularly with a separate access from the street for the accessory dwelling unit. I think that would give more of a sense of a separate condominium or a separate apartment unit. Again, wanting to reinforce this is just another single-family home. During the workshops, during the planning board discussions, and during the public hearings, there were a lot of concerns raised, as you all know from reading the papers, about the notion of an accessory dwelling unit. And we included in our letter to the council several, we use the term reservations, I think concerns or issues would be as well a description. And the first of those was the concern about the possibility of accessory dwelling units fundamentally altering the character of the single-family neighborhoods. And we really think it's important that this community be able to strike a balance for those residents who require flexibility in living arrangements versus those residents who may use the ordinance to their advantage to maximize income opportunities for their properties. And it's enough said. The board fully supports the notion of owner occupancy. I think with any property, that's whether it's apartment buildings, commercial properties, if the owner is there and is overseeing the property is generally better maintained. We do have a concern, however, with the legal standing of that requirement within the ordinance and suggest that the council seek a second legal opinion. Again, under lot size, we had a concern that 15,000 square feet seemed arbitrary. And there's a lot of discussion in the law and case law now regarding arbitrary ordinance, whether it's open space or lot size, and we suggest a real hard look at that. And with respect to the protecting of abutting property values, there were two opinions raised. There were many opinions raised, but two could break them down into two opinions. Those in opposition to the ordinance felt that the accessory dwelling unit would decrease the value of abutting property, one of the most fundamental purposes of single-family zoning in the state. And the proponents of the ordinance felt that with no change in the conditional use standard number 4, which states that the proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent property, that it would, although we would have new language in the ordinance, that essentially the ordinance would continue to prohibit the creation of accessory dwelling units because the zoning board would have to be convinced that the use would not adversely affect the value of adjacent property. I guess in conclusion, what we've decided is that the new ordinance is tailored to have less of a potential impact with smaller accessory dwelling units and with fixed maximum size of those dwelling units, and that we feel better about what we have now in the ordinance, and we think that it would be more successful. We feel better about what is being proposed now than what is currently in the ordinance. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Anybody have any questions for Mr. Emery? Yes. Mr. Linnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I'd like to commend the planning board on this document. I think it reflects...
We had divine inspiration.
Okay. I think that 12,000 square foot idea makes sense. And I wonder, on number 7, when you're talking about a home occupation, I wonder if you, might think about, as you suggested, if it's an electronic business, if it's not a retail business where the traffic is increased, I wonder if that would be a problem. So. And my other thought is on the separate parking area. I think you made a very good comparison that certainly a few teenagers can stack cars in no time, and it would seem a shame to...
Which way?
It would seem a shame that to prevent an in-law apartment or something from happening because of that, because they typically would drive much less than two or three teenagers. That's all, thank you.
Counselor McGlaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tom, can you give me some examples of existing lots in town that are 12,000 square feet or less, besides your own?
I can think of one in particular. I think some of the lots, and if you go through the Brentwood neighborhood, they range in 12,000 square foot. In Brentwood West, the newer Brentwood, they're typically larger than 12,000 square feet. In Brentwood East, they tend to be between 10,000 square feet to 12,000, and some of the odd-shaped lots are perhaps larger than 12,000 square feet. Oakhurst, I'm not sure, that has such a wide range of lot sizes. There may be some, and that's why we looked at the smaller end of the spectrum, as low as 10,000, because there are some very small lots in Oakhurst.
Okay. Following up on what Councilor Linnell commented about on home occupations, how complicated would it be to set performance standards for those rather than having named home occupations? My concern is that I can have a home occupation right now that nobody in my neighborhood would know about if I have a computer, a fax, a modem, and I do it all over the phone lines, and I'm not adding any noise because we don't yell into the phone lines too often. I'm not adding traffic, and I'm not adding visible nuisances. That's why I'm concerned about putting that kind of limitation on. How complicated would it be to put
on? I don't know that it's complicated. I think it's something that probably needs to be dealt with politically. We just felt that if someone went to the well twice, it would be asking more than an average neighbor could tolerate, and it perhaps was such a great temptation that there would be just too much for neighbors to have to deal with. I know that they're not in this community, but in very close to our Cape Elizabeth property line, there are people who have home occupations that deal with, I don't know what exactly it is, but it's distributing, it's sort of distributing to other retailers. And although only one car shows up at a time and our ordinance prohibits activities or discourages activities of that nature, it continues within a very successful neighborhood, actually, that the council went through in their trip last weekend. Some of the council members visited last weekend. And one thing that we heard with respect to accessory dwelling units was a concern that neighbors have that they end up being the enforcers of the ordinance, that particularly as people tend to abuse ordinances, and the code enforcement officer, unless he marches from house to house day in and day out, just simply is not able to be aware of it, to keep up with issues. And it very often is the reporting of neighbors on neighbors that brings things to light. And one neighbor did state that it was very difficult having to deal with a situation where someone was putting in essentially duplex home within a single-family neighborhood, and that neighbor felt as a result of all of the activities of going before to the code enforcement officer that the person in violation really acted in revenge against them in placing a garage and blocking views, and it's just not something they felt comfortable with. So I guess, having heard arguments like that, we were concerned to keep the neighborhood as reasonably close to a single-family nature as possible.
Thank you. Anything else?
That's all for him.
Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Clubshaw.
I too would like to thank the Planning Board. I know you've had many public hearings and workshops and have agonized in private and in public over the whole principle. So I thank you for coming forward with some recommendations and not just returning it to us without any comment.
Yeah, that was always a possibility, but
yes,
we felt we had a greater responsibility.
Yes.
Councilor Dalbach.
Tom, from your experience, and I think I caught the gist of this at the end of your comments, but I'd just like to go over it again. Do we need a new accessory apartment ordinance? in your opinion?
In my opinion as a planning board member?
That's correct.
I would say that if we have an accessory dwelling unit ordinance and the purpose is stated in the affordable housing report as well as some of the goals set forth in the comprehensive plan, that it does need to be amended so that it reaches the people who most need it. It's my understanding that, or who seem to most need it, it's my understanding that the provision was originally drafted because of the oversized houses along Shore Road that I remember very clearly back in the 60s when one could give away large cottages for $10,000 easily that are now worth over $1 million simply because they were so large and the families weren't large enough. So I guess the desire was to subdivide these into two-family or multiple-owner units or to provide an income source so one could continue to live in the unit. Those standards are a little different than someone living in the average single-family home in Cape Elizabeth who may have an in-law who needs to live within the house, who may want to have an extended family that needs. The one thing we heard was, and it's not unusual to have an extended family living in a single-family neighborhood, but it is more unusual, and I think people require more privacy today for some reason. And one thing that we heard is that people who even have their teenage children who have come back to roost or not teenage, but college-age children, post-college-age children who come back to roost, who may be starting careers, is that although they're in the house, they're in a different situation than they were as children, and they want to have them the opportunity to have privacy with their own kitchens and toilet facilities.
Thank you.
Anybody else? I want to thank you, Tom. I think they've done a tremendous job on
this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And we'll look for a motion here, and thank you for your presentation. Anybody from the council care to make a motion or have any other comments? Yes, Councilor Nell.
I'd make a motion that the proposed accessory dwelling units ordinance amendments be referred to the ordinance committee.
Do I hear a second?
I'd second that.
Say that again?
I'd second that.
Yes, Councilor Cogdell.
I hope that we also could have a workshop with the council because we did spend over 3 months on the original proposal and the council as a whole just passed it on to the planning board. So before we spend too many more months meeting on this, I really would like to have some input from the council. So although it's referred to the ordinance committee directly, I will be contacting the chairman of the council to see if we could be part of a workshop agenda.
I think that's an excellent idea, and I think all council members should be notified when you plan to have it and plan to attend. So you set up the date and hope you know everybody.
I'll talk to you first.
Okay, do that. Anybody else? You all understand the motion? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. 7-0. Item 82. Am I correct? Yeah. To consider a request from citizens to alter parking regulations in the vicinity of Placid Park and take any necessary action. I think you all received a letter and some photographs of the parking problems within the family field area, and I think the manager has a comment or two to make. Open this up.
Just very briefly, we did survey some of the residents in the area, property owner, as to their opinion on whether or not there's a parking problem. As you can see from the surveys we received back, there's divided opinion on the issue. Although there's near unanimity in recognizing during the major events there are some parking issues that need to be resolved. Whether or not it's best resolved by continuing to put up emergency no parking signs during special events or some more limited parking arrangement is something that I would suggest be reviewed further by the ordinance committee and suggest this be referred to them.
I see a smile.
Astonished faces.
Not really.
I'll jump.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
I just wonder if that in the cop-out and that we shouldn't pass this right back to the town manager and his administration to deal with the recommendations proposed there.
If I may, I'd be very happy to make a specific recommendation and to reach out to the public in that process. I've just been reluctant to step on the toes of the ordinance committee when it's traditionally been the ordinance committee that does that.
Be my guest.
Here you go. Pardon me. Go ahead, Phyllis.
Counselor Chapel.
Being a member of the ordinance committee, I feel it's a cop-out, too. I think it could be handled. I'm surprised it's on the agenda. A letter from a concerned citizen that hasn't been handled by the people that are there to handle it, which are you and the police chief and the highway department. Put up the appropriate signs, and we'll live with it. I can't see why it's coming to us at all.
And I don't mean to be defensive, but under the ordinances and the traffic regulations, it does specifically require action by the municipal officers, i.e. the town council, in order to put up parking signs that are legally enforceable. We could easily put up signs anywhere we want, but if anyone ever challenged it, it would not be legally enforceable unless the municipal officers took action.
The recommendation is temporary signs when needed, I think.
If you just want temporary emergency no parking signs, there already is an ordinance provision that allows the chief of police to direct for them to be placed with the authorization of the town manager.
Michael, I don't mean that to be derogatory, but when you have something happen at Fort Williams and you don't want any parking all the way through there, you don't have us in session for us to vote it.
Yes. We already put those signs up, and quite frankly, I thought it resolved the problem, and you know, maybe we just need a little more enforcement down there, but there is a citizen who's brought forward a need and wished it to be addressed to the town council, and I feel it's important to bring issues citizens asked to have brought to the attention of the council to the council.
Counselor Couchell.
Yes, after looking at some of these photos that were submitted, I would think we have an enforcement problem, not just parking sign problem, especially when you see the police cruiser trying to wend his way through parking on both sides of the street. So I think part of it's enforcement, and I would like to have had you perhaps recommend something better to us than just throwing it into the committee. If you had spoken with the police and had come up with a plan, and one of these other photos shows just a very thin line of cars, perhaps the whole parking pattern within the park should be redesigned so that you can get more cars off the road.
I would be very happy to return to you next month with a specific recommendation ready for action.
McLaughlin.
I will look forward to that. I was curious about what the activity was on September 17th, since it is after Little League season. And I finally tracked it down, and I very much thank Community Services with coming through for the answer for me. It was a youth soccer event happening there that day, which is not a usual event on Plaisted Field, in my understanding. And I will be supportive of enforced no parking, temporary no parking on the side where the houses are. On, what is that road, Little John, I think, if that's enforced. I have seen it work successfully in the years I parked on the other side of the road when my children were in at events at Plaisted Park, still hard to transition. And I was known to park down by the pump station back there, too. So I don't consider that. I've seen it work with adequate two-way traffic and parking on one side, and I'm willing to support that if that's what you come back with. Thank you.
Councilor Liddell.
Yes, I think certainly a big part of the issue is enforcement, and then I think I would suggest that carpooling and more use of pedestrian and bicycles would help resolve the problem.
Thank you. We'll let you take care of the carpooling and the bicycles. Thank you. You get the people together and you get the bicycles going, and I'll commend you with a medal. So does anyone care to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we refer this back to the town manager for his more specific recommendations.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor, raise your hand. Suppose? It's a vote, 7-0. They said enough, I didn't have. Okay, moving right along to item 83, to consider adopting amendments to the Greenbelt Trail marketing policy and take any necessary action. And I believe we have the chairman of the Conservation Commission here, and I believe she would like to say a few words to us in making her report to the council.
Thank you. I would indeed. My name is Natalie Burns. I'm the chair of the Conservation Commission, and I have with me tonight Jack Roberts, who will present you with some visual aids to help you see what it is that we're asking the council to adopt as part of the Greenbelt signage policy statement. The commission has asked for what we consider to be some minor amendments to the existing policy. One of these affects the height of bollards, which the policy currently calls for approximately 3-foot bollards. We have found in our trail markings that in some areas that is not an appropriate height due either to topographical conditions or to vegetation or during the winter snow. So we'd like to ask that we be given some flexibility to increase that in areas where it's needed to be as much as 5 feet. The major amendment that we're asking for has to do with bollards. As many of you may know, we are required to either place bollards for the location of our greenbelt signs, or in the alternative, we are to chain those greenbelt signs to trees. We found that chaining signs to trees does not work because the chains can be easily removed and the signs are then taken. Bollards, unfortunately, have not been an adequate solution in many areas due to either wet areas or to the location of ledge, which of course presents a problem in the sinking of the bollards. Another thing that we have determined is that in some locations we would like to have flexibility to locate directional arrows where trails may diverge from older existing trails that are not part of our greenbelt system. Having said all that, I'm now going to turn it over to Jack Roberts, who can discuss in greater detail how these changes will actually work in the field.
Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie. What I have that I'd like to give to the council is an updated draft that was provided to you earlier, a couple of the, and some additional information as well. We have requested the ability to use either screws or nails. I had picked up some this evening that are one size smaller than we wanted, thinking that perhaps this would be the appropriate size. But I think what we had initially requested in my draft here is the better size. I also have a couple of Greenbelt logos for those of you who have not seen them previously, just for your information on what size of a metal placard we are intending to use. And I have some maps. I put together 3 maps of the Stonegate area, which right now is an area that we are trying to mark and running into the difficulty in placing the bollards. In fact, Councillor McLaughlin went out with us and she was able to lift them out, so that tells you how well they're secured.
Watch it.
She can do it.
I've also done some research, I believe you have most of it, on some of the other conservation groups that I had contacted. I contacted additional ones as well. I don't have enough for the full council. I did run it off my computer this evening, but I'll give one to the town clerk so that she can make them available to everyone.
Ooh.
Just if I might, while Jack's going back, this usually would not be on the agenda, except the town council specifically amended the policy last time this was on the agenda for what the substitution that's now being made. Sorry, Jack.
Excuse me.
I think you're probably trying to preempt the comment.
The painted markings that Natalie had referred to, that we would place at junctions. As you can see on the Stonegate map, some of those trails are not in place as yet, but there are a number of them that do diverge, and we were thinking possibly that we could color-code trails, so when we put out a map similar to the Great Pond one, when people got in onto the area, they would know which direction that they were going and could follow a trail from one end to the other. And I brought a sample of my firewood that I marked with the size of the arrow that we'd like. Personally, I like the color, but other people tell me it's a little bright. But we can work on that later. But as you can see, it's a lot smaller than some of the samples that I've stated in there, but I think it's quite large enough for our purposes.
Yeah.
Camera, in case they're interested.
I think it looks good.
I like it. It's good. I like that also.
That's well done.
Anybody, you have anything else to add, or you want ready for questions?
Basically, I think perhaps just answer questions if anybody has any.
Does anybody have a question? Yes, Councilor Cogshaw.
Did you discuss the use of screws with Rick Churchill as far as to the long-term effect on the trees?
I spoke with Rick Churchill, with John Switzer, and with Jeff Towling from Portland, South Portland, and Cape Elizabeth. I think their preference would be nails, in that the screws wouldn't do any harm. They felt that the cambium would heal right around it, but they are more difficult to extract. So I think perhaps we might use the nails first and see how those work. I'd still like to have the language say that we could use a screw in case we need to, without having to come back a second time.
If the Audubon Society, the Nature Conservancy, and the Appalachian Mountain Club use paint blazes, why are we screwing things into trees?
The Appalachian Trail uses only blazes. The Audubon Society and the Nature Conservancy also place their markers on trees with nails. I went up to Freeport to visit one of the sanctuaries up there just to see how they did place them on, and they had wooden arrows that were about 15 inches long, and they were placed on with probably 10 or 12 penny nails, which are considerably a larger nail than what we're suggesting to use.
And the other change you have tonight is inserting the word "at least" as far as the size of an informational sign. It says at least 6x6.
Okay. That was something that we had originally discussed when we started working on green belts. I believe it may have been in some of the other language of the other plan. I don't know of any plans immediately to do anything like that in town, but it's part of the policy that we had originally developed.
Yeah, I'm just sort of wondering, because we have had some citizen comments about wanting the citizens to know where the green belt trails are, but not advertising it for the whole greater.
That's why we haven't done
anything. And the 6x6 is a rather large sign.
I think that's.
Would you prefer to use a smaller?
I believe it was a post that had been a 6x6 with something attached to it.
Mm.
And no, there's no plans to do anything with that at the present time, to my knowledge. And
we may want to think about it before we go.
Before we actually do something, that come back and discuss it or whatever.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Councilor Linnell.
Jack, it seems to me it wouldn't hurt to go a little bigger than number sixes. I mean, gosh, they're awful small. There isn't going to be much holding power. They'd be fine with, I would think, eights or tens or twelves even, just so they'd be there.
When I spoke,
but that's up to you.
Yeah, well, the representative that I spoke with at KL, Jack, I had mentioned a number eight, and he indicated that that would, if something ever did hit it, and you got to remember, these are trees that are on a green belt. You know, there shouldn't be anybody out there harvesting anyway, but say somebody did catch it, he felt that even a number eight would be perfectly safe. I made it smaller just to satisfy any concerns on the council.
All right. Well, I think it would be safe enough as far as hitting it. I just think you might.
I would prefer the number.
It wouldn't hurt me. I mean, I wouldn't mind if you went a little bigger. But
I would prefer the eight. I was trying to be conservative.
My another comment is for you to consider. It seems when we're on a green belt and we're so conscious of wetlands, I think it might be desirable to use a cedar post instead of pressure treated. I mean, it wouldn't take much of a pressure treated post to. Yeah, I know. I'm just thinking of the arsenic. Most of them are made with arsenic, and
What we've used for posts have been rough sawn hemlock. We haven't used pressure treated at all for the, along the green belt.
Okay.
The pressure treated that they're indicated was a...
The language refers, in one place it says pressure treated or equal, and another place it says pressure treated.
We've used cedar down at Great Pond. We've used hemlock in the other locations. I believe the reference to the pressure treated would be like an informational sign that's not going to be in our environmentally sensitive area. Although I have researched in a lot of the groups that we're talking, they have used the pressure treated, and there doesn't seem to be much evidence that they do pose any real problem, particularly if they've been allowed to weather at all.
Thank you.
All set? Anybody else? So I just want to say that I don't think these nails or screws are large enough to get through the bark of some of the trees unless you're going to use a certain tree every time. And I'm still not in favor of nailing signs to trees. I like what you had, excuse me, presented there. Painting them, have a stencil and paint them on or something to that effect. But
primarily,
I'm old-fashioned, and so I guess the new regime will nail them to the tree.
I think
nail them to the cross.
About the only place we really want to do that is on treats, street sides. We really need to identify that that is where the green belt starts. And I think most of the members of the commission would prefer to go with the paint blazes as well in on the trails where it's not needed. But our concern is, like, particularly in Stonegate, we can't even get the bollards into the ground on the street side to list where the green belt trail goes.
Anybody else? I lost something there. Okay, thank you. Oh, I didn't see him. Excuse me. Councilor McLaughlin.
You too. Would it work if we had maximum 8D common nails and 1-inch screws? Would that satisfy the concerns I've been hearing tonight?
I think you want to stay away from steel nails.
Do you think softer nails are going to penetrate properly?
I think, as a carpenter, I think that if we went with, we could go with soft screws, either aluminum or bronze,
zinc.
That, you know.
Zinc. Most of mine, they're not that heavy.
Bronze or aluminum screws would do it.
Rather than nails.
Yeah.
Seems to me if the screws get covered up by the cambium layer, then the tightness of that is going to warp things. Isn't that what Rick Churchill said?
Right. Rick had suggested that one optional way to do it would be putting a nail with a spring, that's spring-loaded, so that as the tree grows, it can press back out. The only problem with that, it allows somebody to easily slip something behind the sign and just lift it as a souvenir. And I spoke with two other arborists, and both felt that either a screw or a nail wouldn't damage the tree. Both of them don't like the idea, I guess, the visual idea that people should be running around tacking 40 million things to trees, and we're concerned with that also. So we're not going to, we'll keep it as limited as absolutely possible.
Yes, Councilor Dalbec.
Yes, I think from my standpoint, there are some people here a lot more knowledgeable, I guess, in the council about signs, screws, and nails than I am. From my standpoint, I think we've reached the highest level of incompetence, and I would like to make a motion that we accept whatever the Conservation Commission thinks is appropriate.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? The only comments that I made as far as screws and nails to the tree is not harming the tree, but somebody might cut that tree when you're gone, and their saw is going to get into that nail or screw or what have you. That's what I'm thinking of as a future, not what's going to happen to the tree right now.
That's why
I made the comment, because that does happen, and I can show you barbed wire fences that's been nailed to trees. It's halfway in the tree now, if you want to take a walk with me. Everybody understand the question? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you. Item 84, to consider report from the town manager on the status of the town hall ADA renovation project and take any necessary action. I believe you all received a memo about the project and the costs, and I'll let the manager add a few comments to his memo.
Yes, I'm very pleased to report that the project has moved along sufficiently enough so that it's now been placed out to bid. The low bidder was Centerline Construction, Inc. Dick Miller, who is here this evening, a resident of Cape Elizabeth, is a principal in that firm and is here to answer any questions you may have. When this project first began, a long, long time ago, the original, about 3 years ago, in fact, the original budget was $150,000. At this point, we believe that a total budget of $30,000, more than that, is appropriate for $180,000. We do plan to try to achieve some economies as we go along in the project, but we also do need a contingency. There's a changing of glass up in the doorway under the clock there in order to save $1,800 and a few other things along the way. We're very pleased with all the different aspects this will accomplish. There'll be an elevator just by the back of the flag, where that part of the ramp is now, that will open up on this level, the town office level, tax office level, the cafeteria level, and the second floor level. There's also the doors, as you come in here, the hardware is going to be changed on all of them. A couple of doors are going to be changed. The ceiling up in the office area is going to be totally replaced as a result of some of the other changes that are occurring. The town clerk's office will be doubling in size from what it now is. Where the conference room is on the first floor, there'll now be a walk-in safe, which has been a need that we've had for a long, long time. Proposed to replace the carpet in this room that has not been replaced since 1977 is beginning to show signs of wear, although it has held up really well over that time. This podium itself would be made handicap accessible by moving it forward a little bit and ramping up to it. The assessor's, former assessor's office, or about to be former, in back of this wall in back of us, would be made accessible through the use of the lift that's in the back of the room, would be reused and put over to that site. And altogether, it's a number of changes, all of which I think will not only make the building accessible, but will also enable us to use the building a lot more for a good many more years. And instead of looking for building new and doing new, we're renovating, and we have a real asset here that we would like to keep. Thank you.
Anybody have any comment? Yes, Councilor McGlaughlin.
Thank you. I have a question to Mr. McGovern. I don't understand some of the numbers. Are we looking at just the base bid or the total bid with all three alternates?
That's up to the council.
Okay, assuming we're looking at the total bid.
If you're looking at the total bid, you would need $45,000.
Okay, that was my concern, that $30,000 did not cover what we were looking at. The total bid also does not appear to include a contingency, is that correct?
The $45,000 would include the contingency.
Give me a minute. We have $150,000?
That's right.
It's not a 10% contingency.
It's, yeah, $14,171.
That's not 10% of $18,500, of $185,000. If you do a 10% contingency, you're looking at $203,000, you're almost $204,000.
I think it should be sufficient.
Okay, I just want to make sure we're going to be able to finance what we expect to get done and not have to come back again. Please be asking us for the amount of money that's really needed.
I think I would like to ask for the $45,000.
That was not intentional, I just wanted to.
No, you're right. I think this is when I was rushing out of the office last Wednesday, trying to get my sister moved out of my house.
Love thy sister.
I won't blame her, that's not fair.
That is not fair. Santa Claus is listening, so. So you're looking for additional $45,000?
Yes, and I apologize for that error.
Okay, thank you, I understand better. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I think I wrote the memo before I had the cover sheets, before I had the lower sheets.
Yes, go ahead.
Is there any way that we can revamp this project so that we can come in under our bid?
There are things we could do. We could do, not to come in under the bid, no, but we could reduce the cost. We could do away with the walk-in safe, but we don't really recommend that. There's a doorway up here on the second floor that we could make less historically accurate.
How much is that?
That's the third alternate.
Safe is $10,000 and that's why.
Yeah, the safe is $10,000, no, it's $480. And the carpet in this room is $89.80. You know, there's other things, we looked at maybe trying to do the ramp some other way, but then where Counselor Cogswell's sitting, we run into problems with if she backed up, she'd be off the back of the ramp.
We'll let the new member sit here.
Yeah, there's issues like that that we've looked at. You know, there are other things that are not addressed.
Egress, I guess.
See these beautiful drapes, as someone has pointed out, they're not going to match the new carpet exactly right.
Well, they've got to be.
Well, they'll have to be a blue.
Like, if you get the.
If you get a blue.
Matches the drapes.
They could match.
Or you could knock a new carpet, and then they'd match fine.
That's correct, Representative Marvin.
Would there be any gaping holes after the renovations if we didn't do the carpet?
Would there be what?
Were there any, you know, like, if we move this forward, is that the, are we going to have any big holes, eyesores?
This thing was originally built on wheels, believe it or not, and it was supposed to be over there and face that direction. My recollection is that there's no carpet under it, but.
I think you're correct, Michael, but the big problem.
Is over in this corner.
There are changes, where this change is, big holes.
But would it, if it's coming on top of the, I'm just wondering where you'd see the carpet. I mean, behind here, you wouldn't see it.
You know, even.
On this end.
Would be looking, it'd be up there, you'd see it. Would want to be replacing it in a year or two anyway, and it just struck me that it's the time to get done. You notice by the lift there, we've got a spot where it's starting to bubble up again, and we already have had this stretched, I think, four times. It is beginning to wear, although, you know, it doesn't look that bad, but other than the fact it's 70s, beautiful, but it is starting to be dated.
I think it's in damn good shape, being here 77.
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin.
The manager's proposing that we, if we do authorize this additional money, it come from the fiscal year 95 budget overlay. How much is in that account?
The original was $266,000, and Mr. Daigle indicated to me so far this year it's been reduced by a net of $7,000.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Comment? Motion? Counsel Cogswell.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the $45,000, which would include the contingency fund in addition to the bid that was received by Centerline Contractors.
Second.
Do you want to add to that motion that 45 comes out of next year's?
Out of next year's fiscal year 1995 budget overlay account.
Sure. That's this year's.
That'd be this year.
That's this year, 95, is it?
95 budget.
Everybody understand the motion? Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote.
Thank you, and thank you for being understanding of the error.
Jean, I didn't see yours.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, it was a 7-0. Okay? Item 85, to consider setting a public hearing for January 9th, 1995 on requesting the Maine Department of Transportation to plant a bikeway on a portion of Two Lights Road and take any necessary action. Michael, would you care to?
As I indicated last month, from when the time we put the council agenda together to the night of that meeting, we found out we had another embarrassment of riches. and that was that the state was willing to give us the opportunity to consider as well a bikeway along Two Lights Road. The total amount of this particular bikeway is estimated $120,000, with a grant of $96,000, and a local cost of $24,000, or a 20% local match. It's what probably would recommend for each of these bikeways is that we put the cost off for them into fiscal years 97 and 98. We've done the five-year projections, and that's eventually when we'd end up doing them. But since you were having the public hearing next month anyway in the Shore Road bikeway, pedestrian way, I felt you might also like to hear public comment at the same time on the Two Lights Road proposal.
Anyone get any comments, one way or the other? Councilor Couchall.
Yes, we all received in our boxes a petition from some residents of Two Lights Road. I guess it was headed by Mrs. Polan in support of a bike path. But I have a lot of questions, Michael, that I'd like you to answer as to who pays for the initial studies, and how many times along the way can we veto the whole project if we decide we don't want to go forth?
We assume 20% of all cost.
And that's up front, basically?
That's all of the cost, including design, public participation, and the actual construction.
Who does the design?
The currently MDOT has been doing the design for these enhancement projects. It's my intent to discuss with the new commissioner of MDOT our desire that we work very closely to local, you know, if the council wants to go ahead with these at all, to locally design them, or at least with MDOT designing them, but with them working with a committee that the council would appoint, which would be a change from past MDOT policy. But I think, you know, our new governor certainly is a strong proponent of public participation, and I spoke to a person today who I hope and believe may be the next commissioner, who is certainly a person of the approach, that's certainly approachable in what we would like to do in terms of, you know, not having the traditional MDOT sends a project down. The last part of your question was, when can the council kill this? You know, if you so choose to do that, those are my words, not yours.
Yes.
You could do it tonight. You could do it at the next meeting, or whenever you take a vote on whether or not to go ahead with design. You could do it after the design was completed, at which point you'd be asked to sign a local state agreement, and you could refuse to sign that, and that would kill the project there.
Councilor Marvin.
Who maintains this after it's built?
We do.
So we're 100% responsible for it once the initial building is done?
That's correct.
Do you have any idea what that would cost?
It's not very much, because we already, you know, maintain that existing section, the existing sections of road, so it in fact makes it easier to plow, and it's just that added width of paving when we do pave. It's
Well, the reason I asked the question is that I've seen a lot of bicycles on Route 77 in the road, and when I question them as to why they don't ride on the bicycle path, they indicate it's because it's not properly maintained. So they said that there's cracks, that there's sand, etc., and I was wondering, isn't that going to be what happens if we do this too?
Yeah, we do try to keep them swept, but, you know, particularly what I would refer to as the high-speed bicyclists tend to still be out into the travel lane. What I see, tend to see, are a lot more pedestrians using these lanes than bikers. No, we have a sweeper, and we do go out during the middle of winter now and sweep the Route 77 bikeway, which we used to not, they used to not sweep 77 except during the spring. But now we do sweep it year round.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
Michael, help me and educate me. How did we get this far on these proposals?
There was originally a regional bikeway plan done around 1980. that showed bikeways in both of these locations, both Shore Road and Two Lights Road. Shore Road was referred to as regional bikeway, and Two Lights Road as a local bikeway, a community bikeway. There were a couple studies updated over the years. The town did one on Shore Road in '87. This one has never actually had a study of what a bikeway might do and its impacts.
It's obvious.
Earlier in the year, we submitted grant applications to PACs on a slew of things. These two projects, earlier we'd done the Town Center one, of course, and on the pedestrian part of the green belt over near Great Pond. Never in our wildest dreams did we think everything would be funded. What ultimately happened, everything was funded except the low-cost project, which was the green belt piece.
Thank you. Just so I can go on record, and you'll understand my vote, but I do ride a bike. Probably 3 out of 4 times I ride it, I end up on Two Lights Road. It's a straight road. It's relatively wide. There's very little traffic on that road. And while this might only cost us $20,000 or $25,000, if we can't find a better way to spend $20,000 or $25,000, I'll be amazed. So I will not be voting for this, even to go to a public hearing.
Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Linnell.
I hate to disagree with Councilor Dalbec on financial issues because he is certainly much better qualified than I to on these financial type issues. I think if, as the plan hopes to accomplish, there is more bicycle and pedestrian traffic on these roads, they would, I think, be less maintenance, less wear and tear on the roads. So, although that's, it would be very hard to quantify. But I think the citizens in the area who have submitted a petition, I think their concern warrants going to a public hearing. And some of these details could be fleshed out then.
Mr. Chairman?
That's it. Councilor Chappell?
I just want to, as you know, when we had the vote before, I was on the side of the noes. I just want to clarify that tonight, so when I do vote, people won't get all upset out there. My phone is pretty busy now. If you could show me the necessity and the affordability of these bike paths, I would be inclined to vote for it, I think, to make certain people happy. When I say that, I mean it just like I said it, affordability. I look at the 9 things that I look ahead during the next year, 2 or 3, that the town has would like to do, and that's where affordability comes into my plans. One is the restrooms at Fort Williams. I've been after them for 2 years, and I think they're just as important to Cape Elizabeth and the wonderful jewel that we have out there as bikeways are. One is the fire truck that we just approved, and that is quite an expense for this next year. We bought the gas station next door. That was quite an expense. We got the county jail that's going to be up quite substantially because they're not going to be able to cut that budget to bring it down where it should be. They're going to have to spend that money on that jail, and we're going to be stuck with the bill. The town center plan, there's $400,000 for sidewalks and beautifying that, which I think we've already voted on, but it's still got to be paid for, our share. The $200,000 we're just spending on the town hall, we got to figure that. That's going out this year. The school department never ends. We get it done. I'll be happy when the figures are all in, and we'll see how many custodians and teachers and buses and new heat and new lights and so forth that's going to cost us when we get all done. Close out of the transfer station. Going to have to be done. RWS is in the position now where we're going to have to spend $6 million in Scarborough to close one. Think of it. Ours isn't as big as that, but it's quite something to think about. and the raises for our personnel in next year's budget. We've got to start thinking about those as we get to January, February, and March. We can't just leave the people out that are working for the town and putting their hearts and souls behind things for something we cannot afford. So if you can show me affordability, I would be inclined to go along. On this particular thing tonight, item 85, I am going to vote yes. I'm going to vote yes for one reason only, not to put an endorsement on bikeways, but to let the public have their say here on January 9th. I think it's very important, and I want to listen to them for one, so I'm going to vote yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Nell.
I want to add a couple of things. It's my understanding that the Cape Elizabeth portion of this funding is something that we could do without increasing taxes. If this was something I thought that was going to increase taxes, would expand the budget, I wouldn't be in favor of it. And another thing I just wanted to tell people is that when we looked at some of the speed and safety issues on the Mitchell Road a few months ago, I talked with a lot of people on Mitchell Road, and one of the issues that they, a number of them brought up, was that, well, gee, what we really need is a sidewalk. And many of their concerns would have been alleviated if they had a sidewalk on Mitchell Road. And what I'd point out is, unfortunately, we don't have a, we're not in a position to get the contribution from the federal government for Mitchell Road sidewalks. However, we are in a position to get a significant contribution, a 4-to-1 contribution from the federal government for both the Shore Road project and the Two Lights project. So I think it's worth looking into also for that reason, for those reasons.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yeah, just if there are any folks watching at home and just heard Councilor Chappell's list, I wouldn't want them going to bed really worrying that we're about to see a major increase in taxes other than the school project itself. We have been working on the 5-year plan. We've been looking at all of these pending transportation projects. We've looked at a lot of those other things that you've mentioned as well. And you know, what it shows is this year we're spending $150,000 on transportation projects, including the Sawyer Road reconstruction, the annual paving. Next year, under this plan, we would reconstruct Rockwall Lane. We would provide the match for the town center sidewalks. We would provide the match for the traffic light here at Route 77, and $50,000 of annual paving. That is an increase of about $30,000 over where we are now, up to about $180,000. In 97, 98, 99, and the year 2000, we would continue working on the Shore Road project, the Two Lights project, and a $150,000 drainage project on Shore Road at Tide's Edge, plus paving increasing every year, plus 100,000 miscellaneous projects, all within $170,000 to $175,000 a year. So we're looking at relatively flat funding, even with all of these pending transportation projects for roadway and drainage improvements.
Councilor Dalbert.
But I believe it is appropriate to say that anything we spend is either reflected in our taxes going up or in precluding their going down.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it's important to note that the signed petition, I guess it is, we received copies of this evening, is supporting the construction of a pedestrian bike lane. And this goes along with what Councilor Linnell mentioned, that it's not just for bicyclists, it's for people out jogging, people out walking. And I think in light of the fact that we need to hear input from the residents about their feelings on this, and we already have one public hearing scheduled for next month on the Shore Road pedestrian bike shoulder improvements, I would like to move that we set a separate public hearing, because I think they're going to be two separate issues, for January 9, 1995, 7 o'clock, and 7:30, whatever time. Just lost the clerk on that one. 7:30 in council chambers. I'm requesting the Maine Department of Transportation to initially design a bikeway, a pedestrian bikeway on a portion of Two Lights Road.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? Everybody understand the motion? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 6-2.
5-2.
5-2.
5-2.
I didn't see yours, Gene, I'm sorry.
Well, if you didn't want to vote, you'd hide.
I think it blends.
I won't make a further comment.
She's going for two votes tonight, too.
Item 86, to consider the annual appointment of the assessor and the code officer and health officer, take any necessary action.
So move.
Second.
I believe that you want to, you know, well, I'll read off. The assessor will be Jerry Daigle, E. Daigle. Building inspector Ernest W. McBain Jr. and Jerry E. Daigle. And local plumbing inspector Ernest W. McBain Jr. and Jerry E. Daigle. Deputy health inspector Ernest W. McBain Jr. and Jerry E. Daigle. So everybody can understand who they are. Been moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0. Item 87, to consider entering into executive session to discuss matters related to the land acquisition, disposition, and to provide guidance to the upcoming collective bargaining with the Cape Elizabeth Police Association and take any necessary action. So do I.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved second, we go into executive session. There are no citizens here for any discussion. Is that correct? One comment to the manager. I would like to know the number of events that there is a problem at Placid Park when you put your report together, if you can find out previously.
I'd be happy to try to put them together.
And the next, I want to wish you all a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And I'm ready for adjournment. Motion for adjournment.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am too. Oh, excuse me. Good try.
You may be ready to.
Move to go to executive session.
Don't blame me for wanting to get adjourned, Bill, but you can't do it.
Okay, thank you.
Do we tell them that we won't be back on the air?
We won't be back.
We will not be back on the air, and we'll let the TV people return, go home and close down for the evening. How's that? That satisfy you all?
That's good.